Good morning. Ayanchu, Imanaya Kanshanki. Greetings from a beautiful sunny day in Lima, Peru. My name is Howard Tsai, lecturer and program coordinator at the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies at the University of Michigan. This is the first of a series of interviews that we'll be making that I'm calling Andesmanta Rimasunchis, where I will be speaking to scholars and investigators on Andean culture and society. Today, I have the distinct pleasure to speak with Dr. Guillermo Salas. He is professor of anthropology at the Catholic University in Lima, Peru. Guillermo, nice talking to you.
Hi, Howard. Thanks for the interview.
Wonderful. Can you talk to us a little bit about your research and your research interest?
Well, this is a long history that I'll try to make it short. But first, I research about mining, big, large mines, and mainly about land acquisition and resettlement programs. So it was a frame of political economy, kingship, and economic of pastoralists. So then I got interested in more cultural things, and for my doctoral research, I was very much interested in racial ethnic hierarchies and ideologies in the southern Andes, in Cusco. So my doctoral research was focused on that, but when I arrived into this community, in a small Quechua-speaking community in the highlands, there was a conflict between people that were interested in keeping their traditions of practices relating to the landscape and articulating them with New Age tourism and evangelical converts. So my dissertation became about a conflict between these two positions in the community, ones that condemn these practices and the other faction that wanted to cultivate these practices. And so it was about different ways to negotiate with dominant ideologies of racial ethnic hierarchies and to imagine progress and to try to get monetary income and a moral stand. So through that dissertation, I really got interested in the practices themselves of relating to the landscape, to understand those practices, what they were about. And that's how I got interested in the way in which feeding and cohabitation are at the core of the construction of Andean kinship between humans, but that cohabitation and feeding are also at the core of the relationship between humans and these beings that are the landscape, the mountains, the plains, the houses, the avenues, the squares, everything. Everything that has a name is a person that has agency, has power, and the ways in which they emerge, both with human beings, is through ways in which these beings feed humans and give humans places where they can habitate and live and work, and humans give them back food and respect. So that got me into these new discussions about ontology that that have been at the center of the debates in anthropology the last, I guess, 10 years at least. So that's what I have been doing. I've been publishing articles regarding these relationships of feed and cohabitation between humans and dead people, for example, which includes mummies, for example, that relate to your interest in archaeology, and to mountains and lakes and things like that. And going back to my previous research agenda, I got interested in understanding how, if these beings are alive, how they relate to mining, to different types of mining practices. So I also worked on that, on different ways in which Andean communities relate to these beings, to mountains, in underground mining and open pit mining. So that's more or less what I have been doing in a very short way to present it.
And this is related to your research and publication on Wak'as, right? This focus on animate beings in the natural landscape.
Yes. Well, we worked with Bruce Mannheim, who was he was my former advisor at the University of Michigan. So he's very much interested in a very long time span in the Andes from pre-Hispanic times to the present. So collaborating with him, we work on this article about Wak'as and what their affordances are in Quechua, in Spanish, and in English, and how the archaeological understanding of current understanding of what Wak'as are is radically different from what Wak'as are, which is has a totally different way to relate to a different world, I would say.
Yeah. In my class, we talk about the ritual Quyllurit'i, where there's an annual pilgrimage to the Snow Peak Mountains near Alsangate. Can you talk to us a little bit about your research into Quyllurit'i?
Yeah, Quyllurit'i has been in my the focus of my interest since at least 20 years. Maybe I've been there like 10 times or 12 times. I don't remember how many times exactly. So first, I was very much interested in understanding this practice as how the ideologies, again, of race and ethnicity were framing the way that the Cusco regional society imagined Quyllurit'i. And that has to do with some narratives about claiming that, for example, Quyllurit'i started in Inca times. And many other claims that associated with the great rebellion of Tupac Amaru II.
Can you elaborate more about that, about the origin of Quyllurit'i? There's so many sort of theories about how far back it goes to.
So there is this very strong claim that many researchers has repeated that something really important happened in 1780
right?
Or 1783. Which is the time where Tupac Amaru rebellion take place. So some people say, you know, this is about a moment in which the rebellion was defeated and the Spanish or the colonial administration decided to Christianize the shrine. So that's one way to put it. And the other, more or less, to simplify it, is would be that in these times of such suffering that the whole rebellion came, because it was a really, really tough and bloody rebellion for all parties involved, you know, many, many little villages, towns just destroyed. So it was a time of big suffering, and in those times society creates these spaces in order to focus and to process the suffering. So the problem with all the claims about 1780 is that there is not a single evidence for that. The only evidence for that is, the only evidence that is a totally indirect evidence is a writing of a priest in 1930s, a priest of this parish. So he took the documents, and what I understand that happened is that he looked for the oldest documents. The oldest documents were documents that started to be written after the rebellion, because previously all the documentation was lost because of a fire associated to the rebellion. So what happened is he put into historical time the oral narratives that were about the origin of the shrine and located it into the oldest documents that he could find. And the only thing that is an evidence that there is an element that participates in the pilgrimage is a list of what things remained in this church, in the Okongate church, after the rebellion, like an inventory, you know, of things. And there was an altar to the Lord of Tayankani, which is not Quyllurit'i. So, but participates in the Quyllurit'i, in the complex. So that's the only thing that we have. And what I claim is that what was going on in the 1930s, and since the end of the 19th century, starting of the 20th century, is that more and more there were the neighbors of the town competing with the haciendas for controlling the production of wool. And associated to that attempt to control the wool, they became interested in the pilgrimage, which was a small pilgrimage, local. I think it was a very small local pilgrimage, and they become interested in that, and through that this priest started to write it and put up and historicize it, to anchor it in a document. So, and from there we have this certainty that we are celebrating the 200 and something years of the apparition of Christ in this pilgrimage site. What I claim is that we actually do not know when something started there. We do not know if it was pre-Hispanic. We don't know if it is colonial or if it is Republican. We don't know. There is no evidence. further, there
so it could go either way. It could be either older or newer.
Yeah. What I think it's, I don't think it's an Inca ritual because, you know, some people associated with the Seque systems. The Seque systems were really close to Cusco. And there were important offerings to really, really important mountains. For example, Ausangate, Huamampoma mentions Ausangate, but Qoyllurit'i is not in Ausangate. Qoyllurit'i is relatively far from Ausangate. Mm. So you can see from Qoyllurit'i, you can see Ausangate. Mm. But the whole practices are not related to Ausangate. People in the city imagine that they are related to Ausangate, and that's really powerful because the growing of the pilgrimage, now it's really a big, big, big pilgrimage. Mm. So it's deeply related to the process of migration. Mm. Migration from rural towns to the city and a network that connects urban and rural areas across the region. Mm. And actually in that process, Ausangate, because it's the highest peak, it gives a way to remap a larger landscape in which it's included the small village of the parents or the grandparents that is in a rural area and the city. Mm. So it helps its association of Ausangate with Qoyllurit'i, and going to Qoyllurit'i makes it a more within a same frame of a regional landscape that involves these beings as the mountains and as the Lord of Qoyllurit'i, which is deeply associated to the Colquipunku glacier, but at the same time is not, and can be related as a Catholic Christ. Mm. So this ambiguity helps to associate your new life in the city with a broader landscape that is, let's say less Indian if you frame it in Catholic way, rather than just strictly through offerings to the glacier. Mm. So the growth of the pilgrimage cannot be understood without the migration process in the second half of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And many, many of its rituals that deal, for example, with the city center in Cusco or with other towns are relatively recent. Mm. For example, the ice that was brought until the cathedral in Cusco, it's a ritual that starts, I would say, in the 90s.
Wow. So. That recent?
Yeah, it's very recent. Hmm.
But nonetheless, it's a very emotional experience for the participants.
Definitely.
And you've been on the pilgrimage many times. Can you tell us about that aspect of the pilgrimage?
Sure.
The emotional impact.
So most people that arrive there and that in from any social standing, you know, from any cultural background, New Age tourists or pilgrims, however you want to frame them, maybe to some extent a pilgrim from a tourist can be kind of a not so clear-cut difference. Well, you know, people from the city that just go for putting a candle and to pray to Christ, or people that go dancing from the city in a dance troupe, or that come from a Highland Quechua-speaking community that is strictly more rural. All those people are experiencing this really overwhelming experience of that something really extraordinary is taking place there. So it's so much people and so many dances, so much music, so much things going on at the same time in this very, very high place, which is close to 5,000 meters, makes the experience really, really powerful. Mm. So what, when I have this article in which I discuss Durkheim's notion of social or collective effervescence. Mm. So it's when he discusses the rituals, the annual rituals in, I don't know, Australia, for example, Aborigines. Mm-hmm. In which they come together and they have these rituals and they experience this effervescence, this feeling that you are really, really, really something small in front of this great presence of the totem and all these practices, all psychotropics and dance and singing and feasting. You know, and he says basically that is society, is the reproduction of society. Religion is a way to reproduce society. Mm. God is society. Mm. So what I said taking that and mixing it with more Victor Turner's work and others is like, what happened in Qoyllurit'i is that everybody really feels that extraordinary event, but what gets reproduced is not the same. So depending on your social standing, it can reproduce the certainty that is the mountain that is the agent that really gets these people together and gives them grants of favors and miracles. Other people can think that, can experience and feel actually that is Christ. Christ, this immaterial being that is in, you know, in the paradise or somewhere. Mm. If you think it through more or less canonical Catholicism, you know. And other people can feel that is actually the glacier, but through the power of this stone where the Christ is painted and is not actually Christ in terms of this immaterial being, but that stone in particular that is a being. Mm. And that's very clear in the ethnography. For example, that Lord of Qoyllurit'i is not the same as Lord of Wak'a, which is another Christ.
Yes.
And they are called brothers. Mm. So it means that it's the materiality of the rock that is the actual agent, not some immaterial Christ, and that these two beings are just, these two shrines are just icons or representations of Christ. Mm. So there are many ways to even understand what is the focus of the whole practice, of the whole pilgrimage, the glacier, Christ, or the rock itself. But this, because this is so overwhelming and so confusing, and so the experience of this extraordinary event is just overwhelming you so much, it's not easy to understand these disagreements that are taking place. Hmm. So these disagreements just go unnoticed or are slightly seen, but really the collective effervescence has as one of its consequences the reproductions of different things, different events, different worlds, if you want to negotiate or interact or discuss with the ontological production in the recently discussions on ontology. So these different worlds that at the same time are the same one, that are co-present, but still not openly into disagreement or openly into conflict.
Isn't that the purpose of effervescence, is to mask or smooth over these differences?
Well, to some extent, I guess it's to these type of rituals that there are, I think pilgrimage is a particular type of ritual that because it congregates so many people from so many different backgrounds, in the Andes or wherever, when there is a really massive pilgrimage, really the officials or the priests or the bureaucracy that is in charge of the shrine, it has really, really, really a difficult job to control what is going on. Mm-hmm. So people just do what they really, truly believe must be done there. Mm-hmm. And that really departs from canonical disciplinary ways in which the bureaucracy of the shrine would like that people would feel, would understand the transcendence, the sacred, or whatever else is there. So I guess in this type of ritual, like pilgrimage, yeah, definitely there is an ontological diversity that cannot be disciplined. Mm. While in other rituals that are small scale, more localized, and still there is collective effervescence, maybe the ways in which the elites can discipline the practitioners can be more effective. Mm-hmm. But I would say that certainly collective effervescence, it's a way in which society allows the reproduction of diversity. Mm.
Interesting. Yeah. So tell us about your current and future research. What are you working on right now?
Well, as I was telling you, I am mixing now the two things that I was more involved with. One is mining. The other thing is the mountains as agents, how they emerge through feeding and cohabitation, how they emerge as beings that have agency, intentionality, personality, and all that related actually to Qoyllurit'i. So how? Because there is this, now I'm writing a paper that is, two papers that are dealing with the process of the indigenization of politics in the region that has to do with protests that the organization of these pilgrim dancers are staging, protesting the incursion of mining in the surroundings of the shrine. So in those protests, what is interesting is that they really depart from classic anti-mining protests that are held in Peru, let's say, so which are marches and protests and slogans. What these people do in order to protest is to practice what they do in the shrine, to dance and to go with all their dress, the musics, and the boxes that contain the image of the Lord of Qoyllurit'i, which, because of the relationship with the Qoyllurit'i that is in the shrine during the pilgrimage, this, what we can see at the first glance as representations, are not just representations of the Lord of Qoyllurit'i, but can be understood more as other bodies of Lord of Qoyllurit'i. So in this way, what is happening in the protest is that the Lord of Qoyllurit'i is participating actively in the protest. Wow. And also, if you are from, let's say, the state or the bureaucracy or the mass media that do not get that, definitely the way in which the protest is performed, it alters the way that usually this media understand, or the authorities understand, anti-mining protests, which are easily accused of being violent and criminal and even terrorists. So there's no way in which these indigenous people, this performance of indigeneity, which is implicit, they are not claiming they are indigenous, like in Bolivia, for example, but they are performing something that is clearly grounded in indigenous traditions. So it's very, very difficult to frame that as violent or as criminal or as associated in some way to terrorism. So there is a very interesting way in which these type of practices that are being put in politics are introducing agents that are totally denied to exist from modern politics. Modern politics should be something that has to do with negotiations between humans, not something that has to do with something that could be framed as nature, such as a glacier, or a rock that is painted with an image of Christ. So this uneasy relationship between what is nature, culture, and the supernatural, which is religion, are totally shifted by these practices and challenged. So in that way, this is what Marisol de la Caldena calls indigenous cosmopolitics. Sure. And I'm very much inspiring her work about that part of how Qoyllurit'i's protests are making what she says, like, politic as usual is becoming uncomfortable to deal with that. And so there is that. And the other part of the research that I haven't really write yet about, and I've been working with a former student, Jose Enrique Solano, who is now studying at Michigan, actually, as in the PhD program, is
in
that
anthropology?
Yeah, anthropology. Yes, he just started, I think. And so there is the shrine, there is this mining attempts to mine the surroundings. And in the imagination of the mass media and in the general public is these big corporations that are really trying to really don't respect even Qoyllurit'i, which is so important in the regional society. But when we went there and tried to make some research, what was more surprising for us is that are the actual people that live there, the commoners, the people, the peasants, that the herders of alpacas, who own the mining concessions and who want to carry out mining there. Why? Because through migration routes, they have learned how to process mineral in informal mining in the Amazon and in the south, in Puno, in a site that is called La Rinconada. It's a very, very high mining town. So they actually want to mine these places that are very close to Qoyllurit'i, and they want to do that because they claim that they want to progress using their own natural resources that are in their own territory. Mm. So for doing that, they are obviously negotiating with these beings. Mm. And when these beings are related to mine, they emerge not as Apus, but rather as other names like the Juaniquillo. The Juaniquillo is very similar to what Tosic and Nash have written about the Tio in Bolivia. Ah. So it's that type of earth being, of embodiment of the mountain, but that is perverse and that is very risky to deal with, and that embodies the way in which mining can be harmful and can be dangerous. So they are. So then you have these mountains that are at the core of Qoyllurit'i are emerge as Apus and glaciers emerge as the Lord of Qoyllurit'i, as a Christ, and emerge as these dangerous beings as Juaniquillo that you have to deal with and appease in order to be able to obtain the gold that is there. So then you have this network of dancers across the region organized that are protesting mining, and then you have these other indigenous people that live localized there that are trying to mine those deposits. And they are absolutely convinced that there is gold there, and talking with miners that are interested in projects relatively close to there, it's actually a fact. There is lots of gold that is there. So all the gold that is in the Amazon is coming from those slopes from thousands of years of. Yeah. So it's a very challenging context because it defies the usual narratives about mining, you know, like indigenous people against mining. So these are indigenous peoples that want to do mining.
Interesting.
And that see the pilgrimage and the process in which it has become intangible heritage of UNESCO, for example, in the list of UNESCO's intangible heritage of humanity. They see that process and the whole protests, they see it as a process in which their territory is being taken from them by outsiders. Mm. So, and interestingly, half of this, or more or less half of this community is evangelical. So they say, well, all these dances and all these offerings and masses in Qoyllurit'i are totally mistaken. Those are works of the devil, are not really Christian. Mm-hmm. So Christ, you don't, it's written in the Bible, it's very clear. Mm-hmm. You should not worship any material thing, mm-hmm. which is totally at odds with what happens in Qoyllurit'i. Mm-hmm. So then it's a really very complex mixture of the state that either classifies this as nature or as culture, nature in terms of protecting the glaciers and all the problems with glacier retreat, or as culture, as intangible heritage, or as mineral deposits. A congregation of dancers that challenge that division between nature and culture because this is a being that at the same time is a glacier and a rock. And these indigenous communities that are localized there, that are on that territory, that try to relate to those places for obtaining gold in terms of, in ways in which also challenge the nature-culture divide, but through a very particular reading of the Bible. So it's very, very complex context in which I didn't plan it, you know, like just the social processes came to mix all my research interests in this one site. So that's what I'm now writing about, thinking about, reading about, and trying to understand what's going on there.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Guillermo. Thank you for your time.
No,
thank you for your expertise.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah.
Pleasure to see you again.
Nice talking to you. Nice talking to you. So that was our conversation with Professor Guillermo Salas on collective effervescence, mining, pilgrimage, and other interesting topics about Andean culture and society. So stay tuned. I'll be making more of these interviews next time in Andesmanta Rimasunchis, Sumachia.